Welcome to another Leslie Davis Show. I want to thank my sponsors, the Richfield Bus Company and the Earth Protector Environmental Group. And we have a new technical director, Kurt Scott. I really appreciate having him on board. And we're always trying to improve the quality of the show visually and also with the information. But are you in for a treat now, because we've got Byron Dale here to talk about this money fiasco and give us a little confidence that something is going to change in the future. Thanks again, Byron, for being here.
Thanks for inviting me, Leslie.
Yeah, you know, Byron's an author, lecturer, businessman, been around a couple of years, not as many as I have, but he knows a lot of stuff. So what's going on here? Is there any hope? We're talking hundreds of billions of dollars and trillions of dollars in debt. Where did all that money come from?
Well, it all came out of some bank making a loan.
Making a loan.
Yeah.
Where they get the money to make a loan.
They just created out of thin air.
They don't have to have the money.
No, they just created as a promise to pay. And that comes directly from the Federal Reserve. And, of course, that's a lot of the problem. Because, see, there's a lot of problems that come from that. Because the first problem is right away when all money is created as a loan, there's no money created to pay the interest. Because only thing you can borrow is that which you borrow. When interest kicks in, your debt grows and your money supply does not.
Well, they're only interested in creating something where they can make some money on it.
I know, they never want to deal with the downside of what they're doing. They only want to think about the side where the interest comes in.
Now, the they that we're talking about are the bankers.
Yeah, and their top, we call them sometimes the money elite or the bankers, you know, the people that...
Federal Reserve, Treasury,
and
the banking communities.
And the banking
and
families has been, and, you know, believe it or not, I learned the other day that some of these banks are running off the same charter today. J.P. Morgan, for one of them, is running off the charter that actually was chartered when Aaron Byrd created the bank in 1884, or give or take a couple of years there. Don't hold me.
Morgan was around then?
No, but it's the same families are running it.
Okay.
And the same concept is running the bank. I mean, that's what they're running under. And that was very interesting when I learned that. And the Mellon Bank, for example, it runs off the charter that Alexander Hamilton chartered a bank in 1884. And so these guys have been around a long time, and those same families and those same groups of people have run that same banking concept. Now, there have been changes, you know, name changes, and there's been mergers and all these kind of things along the way.
Uh-huh.
But see, they don't ever stop, as far as I can tell. Now, I've never had the privilege of sitting down and having 2-hour meetings with these guys, and I don't pretend to be able to read anybody's minds or anybody's thoughts. So, you know, I don't pretend to know what they actually think or do. But we can see the actual consequences. Now, let's get into what the consequences of interest. And the first thing it makes the debt grow, but not the money supply.
Interest makes the debt grow.
Yes.
But it doesn't increase the money supply.
Yeah, because if you borrow $100.
You're $110.
And you get $100, right?
Right.
And that's all the money that can go into circulation with that loan. But when the interest kicks in, now your debt starts to grow, because now you're going to owe $110 back at 10% interest, right?
Whatever the interest is. All right.
Okay, so now that means your debt has risen to $110, but your money supply is still $100.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that puts a lot of pressure on things that very few people think about, because now right away interest is the cost of doing business.
Right.
And so therefore now the deeper your debt gets, the more your interest load gets. And even if the interest rate changes up and down, that just makes a difference how much it goes up and down. But the principal of your expenses is still growing, because interest is the cost of doing business. Well, then that causes a growing spread between labor and finished prices, and between raw materials and finished prices. And, of course, that spread keeps driving pressure and pressure to get something cheaper and sell it higher. And if you don't want to sell it too higher, then you got to get your labor cheaper. Okay, see, that's why all the companies are going over to China and other countries to get things built, because they can get the cheaper labor, lots cheaper labor. Okay, but then that causes another problem that nobody wants to deal with, because now that money went over, and if you have a trade deficit, by the very definition, the money's going over and it's not coming back to buy anything, right?
They're lending it back to us.
Well, yeah, but now that's it. Now, don't jump ahead.
Okay.
Okay, because now they've got the money. Now, they got to do something with it, because they're not using it in their own country. Take China, for example. They got a central bank like ours. And so
they take our American money, put it in the bank, the wands or whatever it is that they use.
Wands, I think, Y-U-A-Ns, I think. But that's immaterial. So then they don't have any use for these dollars, so they got to do something with it.
So what do they do?
So they do, like they said, they either buy property in this country or some other country that'll take dollars, or they have to invest in something.
So now they have it. on their computer. We sent it over there, and on their computer, their balance sheet and so on. You know, a lot of the stuff, I really wonder if this information that they're putting into a lot of the stuff is even accurate. I mean, I don't trust anybody in government at this point.
Why would you? But because of the fact that what they've done to us. But I assume most of them, you know, I have a really sharp young man that I know that's pretty good in this, and he worked in a business, and he said, you know, Dad, you understand this pretty well. But he said, even you don't know how much manipulation you can do when money is nothing but numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't really know. But we do know these principles always apply.
And the principle that lending money into circulation as the only way of getting money in at interest is destructive.
Absolutely.
But a lot of times it takes years.
Oh, years and years, you see.
And we're at that point now.
Yes, because when you first get, let's kind of do it compared to a pregnancy, okay? Now, the last I remember, that was a pretty good, fun act, that very first time when we know. But when she got pregnant, well, all of a sudden, and at first it didn't seem to make any difference, did it? And then pretty quick that load began to get heavier and heavier to carry. And then, by gosh, toward the end, that was a pretty uncomfortable situation, as I recall.
Mm-hmm.
Well, see, the debt is the same thing. Because when you first get into it, man, it's great. I remember the first big loan I ever got, man.
Yeah.
I mean, my life just changed overnight.
Uh-huh.
But it was years later when the interest kept going up and you kept borrowing more because I didn't understand it all then.
Mm-hmm.
I was producing all kinds of wealth. I mean, no question. I mean, that's what got me.
Ranching. You're right.
Yeah,
ranching.
I had a ranch and we had a very productive little place, and when it rained, I mean, we did well. But it was amazing how that we never seemed to really get ahead in cash. And that's what got me into studying all this in the first place. Well, how could we all produce much wealth and yet collectively get deeper in debt?
Mm-hmm.
But now let's go back to the principles of how it all works. That's the important thing. Because now when they got this money over here, I got to invest in something. So then they're easy prey for all these guys over here to figure out these new schemes to loan. That's where all this subprime and this bundling and all this comes from.
Subprime and bundling.
Well, because you got these, they wanted, as I understand it, some people in government, Barney Franks was one of them and stuff, and they pushed hard for these banks to loan to these lower income people and these people who was more questionable that they ever pay it back. Well, and of course,
subprime, that's
what subprime really means is your chances to pay it back is a lot less than the guys with a lot more income.
Okay.
But you need a house and you want a house. Most of the American people, it still is the American dream to really have
no
your own
question
home.
About it.
And most people I know like to have their own home. I don't see nothing wrong with that. I mean, I'm a great
believer. No, that's good.
Okay, so now they push them, and these come, I will call them bleeding heart liberals now. Whether that's right or not, I don't want to get in any fight with anybody. But they are, and I think they care about the people. I really do. So they want these people to be able to do that. Well, if you won't address how the money system works, you've got to figure out how to give them a loan to get in the house, don't you? And that's what they call the subprime.
Mm-hmm.
Because they knew that they wouldn't their chances of paying it wasn't too good. So then now.
So who generated the loan to
them?
Well,
all these young mortgage brokers run around.
They were required to.
Well, they would. Well, see, everybody, first off, they was trying to do that to get a commission. Every loan broker I know works on a commission.
Sure.
So the more loans he generates, the more income he's got, right?
So what made him suddenly, did they pass a law in Congress that said you have to give so much to?
I think there was some laws passed, but also there was just a lot of pressure,
mm-hmm.
you know, from the people who have, you know, lobbyists.
Because these houses were being built and they had houses
and they
up
wanted,
the kazoo.
And they wanted to sold, mm-hmm. and so they had to get buyers. And then, of course, the Federal Reserve clearly dropped the interest way down to make it a lot easier. I mean, it's a lot easier to qualify for a loan if you got 2 or 3% interest than it is for 8 or 9% interest, isn't it? Because you don't have to have as much income to meet the monthly payments, do you?
And then they take a big chunk at the beginning, closing costs and fees and all of that.
Well, that's where these young brokers make all their money.
Yeah.
And you can't blame them for wanting to make a good
income.
Well,
They're just selling.
They're just selling the product.
Right.
Well, then they take it to a mortgage banker. Now, he's the one that actually looks through it and puts his dotted line on it, and then that's what then takes it in, and then the banks create the money to fund it. Well, then they sold most of them to Freddie Mae and Freddie Mac. I think I got that backwards, but anyway.
Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac.
Yeah, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Well, so then they was quasi-government. In other words, the government was kind of already guaranteeing those loans, so they didn't care. They was getting the commission, too, so they was just,
there was enough room in it for everybody to dip into this.
Yeah, they were trying to make it a lot of room for a lot of people to dip in. And if you can dip into it a little bit, you're a lot more to go to it, because now I can see where it fattens my paycheck, right? And let's not think about the future. Let's just think about whether or not I'm going to have income today. Mm-hmm. And that's where most of us really do stop thinking. And so now they got these things. What do they do with them? Well, now they got all these investors, and they need to get this money back, because I don't care what kind of money you use. You think about if we used actual physical gold and sent that much overseas and didn't give it back, in a little while we wouldn't have any money to call the country, would we? Mm-hmm. Well, it kind of works that way with the credits, too. If you send it all overseas and it stays there, you're sooner or later going to run out of money.
Because you only have so much credit.
Yeah, even
that
even
you can
credit.
Issue.
You only got the amount you can loan.
Uh-huh.
And if you run out of people to loan to and you're not getting that money back, you still can run them out of there. So you got to get that money back. That's logical, isn't it?
You got to get it back.
Yeah, that's logical.
And they can keep lending as
yes,
they get it back.
Yes, and they can
sure.
relend it and do all kinds
sure.
of things.
Okay.
Or get it back to
logical.
Run income here.
You
see?
Bet.
So now they got these investors. So now how do we do this? And I saw an actual thing the other day from a broker house where these guys had most of these subprime loans was between 3% and 6% interest, right? That's what at that time, that's what most of the loans was for. Well, they rebundled them and mixed some bad ones with some good ones and stuff and put them in a bundle and called them a new investment.
Uh-huh.
Then they guaranteed them they'd make 8% to 9% on that investment.
So they'd give it a rating
new,
or something.
Yeah, a new facial look. And they could give it a better rating because they would say, well, this is all rated according to the good rate mortgages in here. There's hardly any chance of failing. But there was also a lot of loans that was pretty apt to fail, and they knew it. So then see that again, they're bringing all more income for everybody. Everybody's in there. They love this when income's coming in. Well, then they said, well, man, we know a lot of these have failed. So they got to betting with each other on which one would fail first. And then they got the insurance companies in because they wanted to guarantee the bets. Because I don't want to take too big a risk here, so I want to bet, but I don't want to take a risk. So let's insure our bets.
Uh-huh. And that's that AIG
yeah.
bunch or something.
Yeah, and that's what the credit swamps. And I got a lot uh-huh. of this from reading some pretty well-known. One is Ellen Brown, who wrote a really good book on called Web of Debt. And she has a website, www.webofdebt.com.
Web of debt.
I met her personally in Chicago a month ago, so it's really, and I knew her, I'd met her over the phone, and we'd visit emails and stuff, but anyway, and a lot of this stuff, she's in a category where she meets a lot of these financial people and reads a lot of their papers, mm-hmm. and so it was very interesting to have her explain a lot of this, and then these other guys, they put it together, what other economists have said, how it works, and then, of course, you can imagine, When you can bet with money you don't have, uh-huh. just like you can buy and sell wheat and stuff on the commodity markets you don't have, there's hardly any limit to the amount that you can bet, right? And, of course, you can imagine what happens. In fact, I heard two economists in Chicago at the meeting I attended talking about this, and they said, well, we'll just start a little insurance company with $30,000, and we will guarantee all you guys' bets for millions. Well, of course, as long as everybody keeps it working and they just don't have mm-hmm. big losses and little losses and they kind of back and forth, it works. Well, all of a sudden, if you get too big of losses, then they come to you to make it up. Well, we don't have that kind of money. But then we're just a corporation. We'll just go belly up and go out of business. And meantime, we'll keep all the money we got for commissions for doing this and walk away. And
why
they said that's exactly how it was working.
So why do I get the feeling that if we're not successful in this legislation, we're doomed.
Oh, you're absolutely
doomed. I don't see
doomed.
Anybody else out there working on it. I don't hear of anything. I've got a pretty good pipeline of people out there. So when I think of kind of just going and soaking my feet in the Mediterranean in the twilight of my life, I said, well, who's going to get this work done?
Yeah.
And who is going to get it done?
I don't know. Because
who's going to get this bill passed and in the legislature and get them creating this new money and all of that kind of stuff with all the barriers and all the obstacles in the way?
Well, I guarantee if these young kids really do want some change, they better start waking up. Because you can't get change by going back and having the same old guys that was advising people in the past that got us into these kind of problems. You can't possibly get the change out of their minds.
Well, I don't know that I can depend on the 18 to 25-year-old crowd or something like that,
well,
having
but
them
the
get
older
on
people
something
better
like
wake
this.
Up too, because
yeah, but they're not interested in that kind of thing. You know, we're interested in it because we've got a different attitude or something. We feel a responsibility to leave a better world, or we feel they don't have that yet. They're interested in
the
pecker and getting a beer or having some, you know, I don't mean to be crude about it. I mean, but that's just the way young people are. That's just the way kids are. The hormones are raging and the beer need is strong and football's on and all these distractions and stuff. And here you and me, a couple of geezers hanging out in a studio in the middle of nowhere trying to push a piece of legislation save them.
It's pretty obvious. Hardly anybody can listen to the news and think we've been doing it right.
Yeah, but now they're diverted. Now we got to wait for Obama.
Yep.
So now we got 2 months to kill for the transition. So Obama said, well, we only have one president at a time. January 20th is...
my turn. But see, now think about it. Now, this is something that I don't hear very often either, but we ought to think about it. Now, we had a bill just recently passed in Congress to come up with a neighborhood of $700 billion for a bailout, right? And they're going to get it from us, the people, right? Well, the last time I checked, I don't know a single person that can create his own money. Do you?
Mm-mm.
Well, if we can't get the money except borrowing from the banks who need the bailout, well, if they don't have any money to loan to anybody else, how are they going to have the $700 billion to loan to us through the government so that we can bail them out?
They're really playing with us. Burns me up, you know.
How silly can we be to buy this kind of stuff?
Right. And these people that voted for that bailout, they ought to be tarred and feathered and thrown out.
Because, nobody stopped to think about the origin of money. You go out and ask 1,000 women on the street, just go up and down and ask them. I'll bet you won't find a single one that don't know where the origin of people comes from. But you say, ask the same people where the dollar originates from, and I'll bet you can't get but 3 answers at anywhere near close to right.
Okay, but so who cares where it originates from, because like Greg says, all people know about money is they love it and they want more of it.
That's right, but if you can't get more of it and there's a problem, and the ones who create it are the ones that need the bailout, and the ones that can't create it are going to give the ones that can create it the bailout, we're going to have to borrow the money from them before we can give it to them to bail it out.
But they say, that's not my problem. They got Obama and Volcker and Rubin and Rahm Emanuel and Biden and all those same folks again. And we need to give him a chance. So here goes another 2 months.
They had a chance the last administration.
We're agreeing. I'm talking rhetorically and you're talking.
This is what you have to do.
So
you
here we go say, again.
Okay, so now let's stop back and really start to kick our brains in gear for a change and really think some things about in actual logic and common sense and based on principles.
And tell it to who?
To everybody to listen.
Well, that's what the show is for, I guess, to tell the people
what
to
I
do
think
that,
it's for. That. In fact, Leslie, I ran into a woman the other day, and I have met this summer, and I've explained this to her a little, and I don't think she paid much attention, and she was listening to your show, and she said, when the second one finished, she realized she'd seen it once before. But she said, you was making lots of sense. It's true, you can't borrow yourself out of a debt problem. So we're having an impact. And if she thought that, how many more people are starting to think that?
But unless we're in a position of power, more than maybe having a Coke with a legislator or something like that, we need to get some clout.
Well,
we need to get this Governor Pawlenty.
A lot of clout you can get by just having a few people that can get you into these people and a few people who will start calling their own legislators instead of sitting on their duff and doing nothing. But before you can get them to do that, you got to get them to understand the problem. And if you don't understand how money comes into circulation, you will never understand where your problem comes from.
But listen to my frustration. Greg meets with the governor. Not a governor. He's gone to college. He's gone to law school. He was a city councilman in Eagan. He came back. He was in the legislature. Worked himself up to assistant speaker of the House and became governor. He's been governor for 6 years now. And he doesn't understand it. And we've spoken to his aide and all of that kind of stuff.
Well, I've spoken to him 3 times personally myself.
Well, there you go. You're talking to the governor. Greg is talking to the governor. I'm talking to some of his staff and stuff like that. And we're still back at square one.
Well, not necessarily.
But I'm not defeated. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here,
I know that.
But I'm just wondering what we need to do to really make this happen.
Well, we need slowly, and I have a young fellow that just came on board, and he's understood it for 14 years.
Is that Leon?
I don't like to mention a lot of names.
Okay, but that's a first name only.
And once, but you know, he made this his own personal project here this summer. And
Do you have a regular job?
Yeah.
Okay.
And in fact, two of them.
But well, you got to have two at least today.
But he had just made great strides. He just seems to have a knack, better than anybody.
Explaining it to people.
Yeah, and get them to see it, and getting them come on board. It's just the best phone calls I get in the day is when he calls in the evenings and tells me what happened that day. Uh-huh. And he don't have all good days either. He called back the other day and he was really disappointed. He'd had a pretty bad day. Mm-hmm. But things like this are happening. And of course, see, there is such a thing, and I really believe on it more than anything else. And when an idea's time has come, it moves. And we never know, and you've talked about the tipping point. Well, when do you know for sure when an idea's time has actually arrived? Mm-hmm. And it's closer, because I guarantee you, a year ago, everybody wasn't thinking about the financial situation like they are today, are they?
Yeah, but you know what concerns me, Byron, is that we could be on a track that just destroys America. I'm going to say, oh, well, we'll figure it. Well, we'll pull it out, or its time will come, or something.
See, you're in my definition.
Am I too scared? Am I too worried?
I think so. My definition of destroying America is a lot different than yours.
And well, if you don't have any money and you can't, nobody takes your money anymore.
That's true. But all of a sudden, if that changed overnight, everything would come back to the better overnight. We're still going to have all the land. All the houses are going to stay here unless we have a nuclear war, the stupid guys, and blow it all up. All the houses are going to be here. Now, I know Detroit and some of them are tearing them down as fast as they can when they foreclose on them because people vandalize them so fast. But at the same token, most of these houses are still going to be here. I guarantee you the land is still going to be here. Mm-hmm. Most of us will still have knowledge to do things. And a lot of the people who don't, they might find themselves sitting in a real bad place.
Okay.
But you'd be surprised how innovative the average person is to get something done.
But you're talking about going back to primitive times and so on. You know, the auto workers are all going to lose their jobs and they're merging together and they're worried a bailout for the automobile company. They're nationalizing our nation.
Well, see, but that in itself.
Government meddling into our business,
that,
sniffing in our cars.
But you just think about how quick that could all change if this idea began to just all of a sudden start moving word of mouth. How long did it take to get everybody buying a hula hoop? Well, tell me.
I don't know.
How long did it take to get almost a microwave in everybody's home?
Once somebody saw somebody doing a hula hoop, they got one right now, you know.
So, see, this is the thing that we have, I really believe we have working for us.
But this is a lot different.
Oh, it's a lot different.
Than
but the
putting
concept
a frozen
is
piece
kinda,
of meat in a box and watching it come out ready.
But it's not much harder than trying to learn to use a computer for the first time when you're 60 or 70 years old.
Uh-huh.
And I know people who've done that. And
well, those of us that are working on this, and I learn a different piece every day when I go to a computer. I see frequently asked questions put out by the Federal Reserve Bank. And they're saying, because I'm saying, they say, who puts this all this money? I said, it's controlled by the Federal Reserve Bank, which is not federal, not a reserve, not a bank. It's a private bunch of bankers. And the Federal Reserve themselves say, oh, we're not private bankers. We're part of the government, but not quite the government. Well, what are you?
That's right. But now, come on, Leslie, you're old enough to know when you've been lied to and when you haven't.
Sure. But what
do
I do about it?
What you do is what you're doing right now.
Okay.
You're doing the best possible thing that you could do.
I'm just kind of hoping that we can get that bill through this time around.
But see, just think about the impact that you're probably having. And just if you do nothing else but just film us having different conversations and talking about the real issues of what's happening, why it's happening, the background of why it's happening, and what we can do to make it really better.
You know who should jump on what we're doing? These chambers of commerce.
They
should probably
they
be
should.
Going and talking to them about it, because they say, I don't have anything at stake. I don't have any money. I don't have a 401k. I don't have a house or a car or anything like that.
And you ain't got nothing to worry about.
And I don't have anything
you.
To worry about. And I just got a borrowed cat that somebody rescued gave to me to take care of. So I really, but I've got some grandchildren, you know.
Yeah, and you've also got a desire to make things better.
Yeah.
And that's the most important thing of all.
Right. And this is the most critical thing.
Well, this is what this is the key to everything.
Right.
How money works is the key to everything.
Right.
Because money is a lubrication that runs everything.
Mm-hmm.
And if that lubrication is a rotten, no good, corrosive lubrication, right, things go down, don't they?
Yes.
If that's a really good quality, smooth running, sustainable lubrication, everything gets better, doesn't it? Or at least runs a lot better and smoother.
But I'm having a, maybe that's my personal difficulty. I explain it to people how the bank, I said, well, where would they get the money from? Or like the, I'm almost stuck where the governor is, you know? Except, I get the concept of how the bank can create the digits and send them over there, and that's how it all happens. Because if they can create it as a loan,
they can create it as a payment just as easy.
As a payment.
Well, sure they can.
Sure.
If you can write with this pen, you can write with that pen just as easy, can't you?
Uh-huh, yeah.
If you can write a minus with that pen, you can write a plus just as easy, can't you?
Okay. Well, we're coming up with about a minute or two to go. So if you have something in closing other than...
My thing in closing, Leslie, and I'm sorry, I just personally want to thank you for having the time to sit and visit with you,
yeah,
and have people all over the city, this Minneapolis area,
it's
be
in
able
Duluth
to see it if they want to watch it.
Okay.
And because, see, just hearing it, you can't believe how many people is going to start making them think.
Okay.
And that's the very first step. First, before you can accomplish anything, you have to get the mind to get kicked in gear.
Got to be thinking a little bit.
That's right. And once that happens, and then pretty quick, and I see it much more. I can remember when I was the only guy that talked about this.
Mm-hmm.
And now I can name lots of people that talk about it at coffee and other things.
I'm really proud of the way Greg understands this thing.
Well, Greg's put a lot of time into it.
He's got nice paper. Listen, if you want some paperwork on this stuff, we can go on and talk about it forever. But we need you to step up with us and send for this little paper called How to Spend Money into Circulation with No Interest and No Debt. Byron Dale is showing us how. Greg Soderbergh in Austin, Minnesota, showing us how. You people ought to be calling and talking about it. Byron, thanks again.
Thank you,
Leslie. Another patriot doing good work. So
well,
I'm inspired a little. You came down to do this show. It's Sunday afternoon, and hopefully my viewers will take an interest in the money issue.
Yeah, you made me miss the end of the Viking game.
End of the Viking game. Were they winning, or what was going on?
No, they was losing.
Yeah, okay, well. Too bad for them, but you keep watching the show and keep your mind on your money, and you can't count on the same old way of it happening. There's going to be a new way, a paradigm shift in the way money is brought into circulation. Byron Dale, Leslie Davis saying, thanks for watching.